Oh, hello there, viewers. Don't mind me, I'm just putting the finishing touches on my entry for this year's Big Finish Short Stories competition. It's going really well so far. What are you doing here? Oh, right, yeah. Sorry. So, Timewyrm Revelation. Did you like it, Ben? Do you think it's good? Well, of course I did. It's the debut work of Paul Cornell, one of the most lauded Doctor Who writers around. In most circles, anyway. The fascinating thing is that had I not known what this book would turn out to be, I would have guessed that we were in for a car crash. The quality of the Timewyrm miniseries so far has been all over the place, it's saddled with the most obnoxious villain in the history of quite literally anything, and now another new, untested writer is going to barge in, try to make sense of this unassembled pile of nonsense, and go about the Herculean task of trying to knit these disparate ideas into a sweater that leaves the audience with sufficient narrative closure and at least one nipple left unchafed. So, St. Paul, pray tell, what's your solution? Our starting point is that there's a village with a sentient church named Saul. The Doctor has been dipping in and out this place for years. At one mass near Christmas, there's a priest and a recently bereaved married couple who've moved into the village. The Doctor barges in with Ace. The whole thing is revealed to be a trap. The village is actually on the moon, and the Timewyrm has recruited Ace's childhood bully, Chad Boyle. Ace dies twice, and then wakes up in hell. The Doctor is soon killed too by the personification of death, and wakes up there as well. All the while, the sentient church and its inhabitants try to figure out what the Doctor wants them to do. Now, that's a lot of plot, and I'm honestly surprised this novel hasn't just decided to omit everything that's come before it. Hemmings from Timewyrm Exodus is back, although apparently he was Cornell's ideas first rather than Dick's. Timewyrm's Ishtar identity and the past Doctors appearing in Genesis and Apocalypse are factors in the plot. I'm always impressed when a creative makes a bad idea work by working with the idea on its own terms and not necessarily throwing out the baby with the bathwater. Whenever I review a story that's clearly had monumental influence on what came later, it could be a challenge not to turn the video into a list of stuff that I've seen before that's clearly been borrowed from this. Let's see, a child in an astronaut suit, buildings being transported to the moon, little English villages whose residents turn people they don't like into dust, the villain getting turned into a baby, temporarily killing the main cast members early on to grab the audience's attention, all the other Doctors existing inside the Doctor's head, obviously, the climax being a rejection of utilitarian-motivated sacrifices, subverting a more gunnish approach and reaffirming the Doctor as a hero and not a warrior. Check, check, and check. And that's just the things I noticed. There's probably loads more. And Jesus Christ, does that explain so much? Time Woke Revelation, yeah, of course I was going to use that one, is patient zero for New Who's SJW-itis. Every villain is a racist. Like, one racist you could have gotten away with, but two at the same time, it's just unrealistic. But what else is to be expected from Paul Cornell? His initials are literally PC.
And as so many people have remarked, nobody had ever tried this before. Except, of course, Paul Cornell.
So no sane person could deny that Timewyrm Revelation lacks craft.
Oh, there's a loaded sentence, Ben. You wouldn't happen to be leading up to some contrarianism now, would you?
Alright. I was really into this during the first 20 to 40 pages. It's intriguing, the prose is good, and ooh, the Ace and Seven conversations have subtext. The ending really had me, and I've got to confess, this is probably mostly my own experiences. I read this in probably the worst conditions possible. The nightmare assortment of time that I've convinced myself is a workable schedule. Nothing got to the point of being a deal breaker, but I do think I prefer this level of dreamlike plotting and little immediate context in something like TV or audio, rather than prose.
My particular cocktail of neurodivergence can hamper my reading, and whenever we cut back to Saul the Church or the Timewyrm's POV, I could feel my eyes glaze over. And to be honest, I
don't understand why the twist that this is all inside the Doctor's head comes as late as it does. Ace believing that she was genuinely in hell was an interesting character beat, and I think it plays very well, but they know it's not actually hell by at least halfway through, so why not reveal it then? And whilst the novel plays coy with the identity of the first and fourth Doctors, three is just referred to as the third Doctor, which seems a little odd and something that another draft might have caught.
But without trying to sound pretentious, this might actually be the point Timewyrm Revelation is making.
If I had to sum up its thematic content, I suppose it would be understanding. It's about the interaction between scope and our perspective, how close we are to something we observe, and how this interacts with our subjective beliefs. Now that's not an impressive insight on my behalf, because that's blatantly in the text, whenever the Seventh Doctor talks about fractals, how you understand something depending on your distance to it. Chad Boyle isn't important on a cosmic scale, but to his victims, he's the whole world. Popperina has said that it's about the importance of small kindnesses. Elizabeth Sandifer has talked about the same conflicts operating on different scales. Religion comes up a fair bit here. Obviously, we have Saul the Sentient Church. There's the Buddhism of the Third Doctor's era, Hemming's belief in Norse mythology. Rather than saying something about faith specifically, these are compared to different perspectives. How each of the characters trapped in Saul's church perceive the sounds that the creature is making, whether it's poetry or mathematics, depends on their careers, their worldviews. We're presented with so many different ways of understanding the universe. So, a novel that's only 130 pages in a franchise that's off the air and out of the public consciousness must look quite small from a distance. But when you take a closer look, it's an almost dizzyingly dense text, full of huge ideas and scope, and that's appropriate, isn't it?
So am I stupid, or is this another way of saying everything is bigger on the inside? No? Does that work?
I think it's safe to say that by this point, the Seventh Doctor has adopted a fairly utilitarian streak in his decision-making. And sure, one life looks small when you're staring at billions. But Seven doesn't have the luxury of distance with Ace. We don't have that luxury. We know her. We've seen how complex her thoughts are. And through the Doctor, we get an example of just how multifaceted one person's thoughts can be.
The book tips its hand. Its climax depends on the fact that whatever perspective of the universe you decide to take, morality, your conscience, must play a role in it. Though it did lose me slightly when the Doctor's conscience took the form of the Fifth Doctor. Sure, Paul. But back to the matter at hand. It equates things being fractal and a more complex way of looking at the universe with maturity. Ace, the Timewyrm, Chad Boyle, they're all compared to children. Well, Chad Boyle is a child. So this greater understanding of the universe, this proximity, is linked with growing up.
She suddenly dived forward on the ground and kissed the snow, tasting it. All these snowflakes, all different, all so short-lived, but all beautiful. From a distance, they all looked the same, but close up, they were so complex and different. A child would bundle these snowflakes up and throw them at another child. That was cool if you were a kid, no harm in that. But she wasn't a child anymore. She had come back.
This almost begs to be read as a statement on the Virgin New Adventures themselves. What should they set out to be? What does it mean to be Doctor Who for grown-ups?
So far in the V&As, I've been assessing, in my own subjective opinion, whether the book versions are as interesting as their TV counterparts. And here, yeah, no surprises, Cornell's writing of them kind of is the ruling standard so far. The question of whether something is in character can be a bit tricky and hyper-subjective. I know plenty of people who liked Seven and Ace's conversation in Power of the Doctor. I also know people who went, what the fuck? But I think we can acknowledge the truth that when characters are no longer in the hands of the writers, directors, and teams that created them and their journey so far, when they're taken into new hands, you're dealing with a reaction to a previous portrayal rather than a continuation of the current one. Now, this doesn't have to be a problem, but it can become obvious the further it's been since these characters were last on our screen. Because then, the story's had more of a chance to live in its fanbase's head, the more it's been mythologized and immortalized in memory and... Okay, you know what I'm going to say. We all know that one of the bad habits of franchise storytelling in recent years is to convince excellent actors to recite lines that were memed to death and be ready to recapture the souls fleeing their body as a show of loyalty to standards. Whilst there are a couple of lines from Seven's run that do reappear here, they recontextualize and come up really naturally.
Honestly, you shouldn't even be trying to recapture what they were like on TV at all. If their stories are going to progress, they're going to take on new leases of life, and they're going to change.
Instead of rehashing old iconic lines, come up with new iconic lines. Yeah, I know that's easier said than done, but this book manages it.
Hello, he said. Welcome to my brain. Sorry, this place is such a mess. I remember Sherlock Holmes expressing similar sentiments. Yeah? Ace was interested. Did you meet him? Oh, right. He wasn't real, was he? Just because somebody isn't real, it doesn't mean you can't meet them, murmured the Doctor with a sly smile.
Ace in particular really does sing in Cornell's hands. Through this book alone, you gain such an understanding of how she turned out the way she was, why she embraced what she embraced, why she believes what she believes, why does she have the scars that she does. Manisha has been touched upon in the V&A so far, but her appearance in Ace's dream sequence is really sad. Ace's relationship with Seven is multifaceted. She can go from hating him to loving him in such a short span of time. I can't believe I never made the connection before between her and the Doctor both having homes they don't want to return to.
So, that's Timewyrm Revelation. I'm honestly feeling kind of bittersweet having read it, because I'm wondering if something like it could exist today. Now, that may sound kind of stupid given how I opened this video by talking about all of the Doctor Who we've had since that resembles it. But that's my point. It's been 32 years since this came out. When are we due for our next big reinvention of Doctor Who? By the time I'm writing my next short trip to Big Finish's competition, I will be 24, the same age Paul Cornell was when he wrote this. A guy around my age who'd mainly only written fanfic, and with just this one book, his very first book, he changes the whole franchise forever. That's the dream. That's my whole fascination with this era. It's why I decided to review these books. And it's kind of the appeal of Doctor Who to me these days. But again, can that be said for Doctor Who now? Because even when we get new blood, even when people around my age start to pass the barriers for entry, when they get to write for Big Finish, when they get to write for RTD2, will they ever truly be in a position to make the impact that Cornell was here? Timewyrm Revelation is a lot. It probably has more ideas in it than it needs, but honestly, I wouldn't change a thing. It's one person's utterly unfiltered, uncompromised, unique vision. It felt like I was taking a journey through Cornell's head, never mind the Doctor's. There's this one bit where Ace meets these three witches who represent the Doctor's feminine side. It's a blink and you miss it moment, but I'm so glad it's there. Little gems that a new writer comes up with might be omitted, that might get lost between drafts. Will a writer my age, will one of us get the chance to change Doctor Who forever? Or will we be bit players? Tellers not of our own stories, but helping to tell the same stories we've been seeing for decades.
Oh, shut up and get a job.
How could you make it as a writer? When have you ever kept to a deadline? You're getting this short story out at the 11th hour, And Jesus Christ, do you have any idea how many times you've pushed this video back? Don't pretend you're making a statement about the industry. This is about your own shortcomings.
Right, that's it.
You're going in the fucking pit!
He's not actually going to—
Oh shit! Get off me! No, put me down! Fuck off! I don't wanna go in the pit. I don't wanna hang out with Peter Davison.